everyone.
Good morning.
Well, it's my pleasure and privilege for me to be here. I'm coming back. Sometimes I feel like I'm gonna die because I feel like the only thing I haven't done is probably my will. And told my sister the other day that you know, if anything happens, she can take anything and everything that I have and sort it all out. But yeah, it's Fountain is just really a special church for me. So it's a pleasure for me to be here to just share God's word and pray that we all can, and you know, this I'm going to share with you actually. Something that I'm not necessarily proud of, and but we all can learn. None of us are Polish Christians, and I think the best thing for me to do is to stand here and to say that I'm definitely not a Polish Christian, and you can see all my flaws. But so before I continue, I just really want to pray again, if that's okay with you. Father in heaven, I just want to thank you that it's the Sabbath and we can worship together. And we thank you, Father, that this is all about you. It's not about me, and it's about your word, and it's about your truth. And may you speak to each one of our hearts, and that the Holy Spirit will also be with me, that I can present it in a way that will bring glory to your name, and also draw me and draw everyone here and to a closer experience with you, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So, today I'm going to be talking about a woman. And I don't think she's necessarily an old woman either. Because when we think of widows, sometimes I think, oh, it's an older woman. But I don't think this widow is an old woman, and she's got a son. Lay the foundation of what we're talking about. I want to share with you that at times God, you know, he does mysterious things in the way that he works. And I've put up here that God uses the least unexpected to help us. And then he uses us to then reach out to the least unexpected as well. So it's the story of Elijah, and I love the story of Elijah. There's just so much stuff in his life, and Elijah and Elisha, and I've just been really impressed by some of the things that are written in God's word. And I wonder if Elijah will, you know, he'll be surprised when we all get to heaven and when we meet him and we say, oh, we've heard all about you, and we know all about what you did, and he'll be thinking, wow, how did you hear about me? And little did he know that his life has really been written in the Bible. So I'd like to invite you to turn with me to grab your Bible, or your phone, your iPad, tablet, and just to look into this word here in 1 Kings chapter 17. Now, some of you would know the story, but I'll lay down some foundations, and then you will know whether or not some of you may not be familiar with the story at all. 1 Kings chapter 17, and I'll read from verse 1 to verse 7. It says, Elijah the Tishbite of the inhabitants of Gilead said to Ahab, as the Lord God of Israel lives, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years except at my word. So right now, just to pause, at this point in time, Elijah is there, and he is kind of like really what the other prophets, the rest of the other prophets in the Bible, a minority. And the majority are those who are people who have really strayed away from God's word, and they have not lived according to what God has given them, the truth. And so here Elijah comes to Ahab, the king of Israel, and he says, no more rain. There will be no more rain. And of course, then Elijah, anyone who says anything against the king will be punished. And especially if it will encroach on his power, on his success. So Elijah here speaks and he says to Ahab, there will be no more rain, there will be no more dew, and this is what's going to happen, and this is coming from God himself. So let's keep going, because here Elijah is in fear, and God has, while Elijah is thinking Ahab is going to get at me right now, God protected him. And this is how he protected him. Then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, go to verse 3. Get away from here and turn eastward and hide by the brook Cherith, which flows into Jordan. It will be that you shall drink from the brook, and I have commanded the ravens to feed you there. So he went and did according to the word of the Lord, for he went and stayed by the brook Cherith, which flows into the Jordan. The ravens brought him bread and meat in the morning, and bread and meat in the evening, and he drank from the brook. And it happened after a while that the brook dried up because there had been no rain in the land. So what has happened? What did God provide for Elijah at this time?
His needs.
His needs, yeah. So firstly, he wanted to protect him. So he says, go, travel. So he was in Samaria. And so he had to basically go up onto the Cherith Brook there. And he says, go there in the wilderness and stay there until I tell you where to go. So this is what God commanded him to do. And what did he find when he got to the wilderness? Well, to the forest. He was fed by the ravens. He was fed by the birds. And then secondly, he was also, how did he drink? He had water from the brook. So from the creek or whatever it is, the river at the time. And so here was a time when there was possibility for him to be able to receive every single day, food from birds, yeah? Okay, that's amazing. And every single day there is also provision of water. And I don't know if you've ever drunk water from the river before. Yes. When I went to, it's an awesome experience. I went to Solomon Island and never would I drink water from the river here. But I went to Solomon Island and we had to go up in the mountain, and but the way I drank it is also, I'm a bit of a wuss, because we had this little tube thing, and it's like a filter, so it acts like a straw, and you drink, and you put this tube down into the water, and this is the river, and you basically suck the water from the river through, and it's supposed to filter it. And so I remember drinking and I thought, wow, this is just an awesome taste, the water. And I remember someone actually decided, I don't think we need this. This water is really clean. And they were just drinking it directly from the river. And it's a beautiful experience when you can actually receive something from nature. So the birds provided food, and then also the nature provided the water. But then it ran out, the water. So of course, we can't survive without water for 3 days? No water 3 days, you're gone. So what did God do? God still provided for Elijah. Now, if you think about this, God is a God who is the one who provides so many things. Firstly, he's providing through the ravens. He's providing through the brook. Now what he's going to do is he's going to provide through the widow. And you're thinking, the widow? The first thing I would think of is that, okay, if I was needing accommodation somewhere, and in fact I do in the US, I need an accommodation, then I'd be thinking, if God's going to provide for me, he'll provide someone who can provide, yeah? Someone who can provide. Someone who has the ability to give, which means that they would have something that's enough as a spare that they can give to someone, or an availability anyway. So, but God here chose a widow. Now, a promise here says, Philippians 4:19, my God shall supply what?
All.
Not even some, not even, maybe sometimes. But he says, supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. When I think of this story of Elijah, I thought, wow, God is a rich God. Amen? We have a rich God. We need no fear that we will be poor, because we have a rich God. If you need something, he will provide. And if he doesn't provide, well, maybe it's not the right timing, or maybe you really don't need that. Or maybe he's going to show his glory through something else that you will be provided for at the right time. But whatever it is, I mean, God used the bird after all. I mean, magpies just take my peanut butter sandwich from Tarama Station while I'm sitting there, and instead of giving me food, they would actually take it. But here it says, my God shall supply all your need. All your need. So let's go to the story of the widow. So he comes over, God then says to him in verse 8, then the word of the Lord came to him saying, and I'm just thinking when I was reading through this, Elijah hears the word of God. I mean, he must have been so quiet in that, you know, wilderness, that he could hear God speaking to him. He could hear God saying, this is the way that you should go. And there is another promise in Psalm, you know, this is the way that you should go. Walk ye in it, turn ye to the right hand or turn ye to the left. So here God says to him in verse 9, arise, go to Zarephath, which belongs to Sidon, and dwell there. See, I have commanded a widow there to provide for you. So I mentioned before, a widow to provide for you. And so this is interesting, because this is when Elijah is probably, I mean, if I was Elijah, I'd be thinking, come on, I'm not going to ask a widow, sorry, that was just my cup. Just leave it there. He's thinking, how can I ask a widow for something? Right. How can I ask a widow for something? Because a widow back then, if you have no husband, if your husband's dead, you have to look after your child, and how are you going to work? So she's really scraping for her needs. And so, but here God says, no, you go there, you go to Sidon. Now, another thing is, Elijah, he is trying to be, he is running away from Ahab. And Elijah's name is pretty much like the wanted name. His head is on a nice platter, and everyone is looking out for Elijah, because Ahab said, I want to get this man. We're going to look for him, and everyone's been looking for Elijah everywhere. So Elijah here is he's just not safe anywhere. Now, Ahab's wife, Jezebel, the known woman, and she is actually from Sidon herself. So it's interesting that Elijah is running away from the very king who is trying to, you know, chase after him, and God is taking him to the very hometown of his wife. And so Elijah will be thinking, as if I go to, you know, Jezebel's hometown, what if she comes and visit there? That'll be scary. But no, Elijah still continued to go and see this widow. And this is where Elijah's faith would have been even more, he was strengthened, because he could see that God had provided him all the way through, and God protected him in the time of the wilderness. So he goes over to this widow, and let's read from verse 10. So he rose and went to Zarephath. And when he came to the gate of the city, indeed a widow was there gathering sticks. And he called to her and said, please bring me a little water in a cup that I may drink. And as she was going to get it, he called to her and said, please bring me a morsel of bread in your hand. So she said, as the Lord your God lives, I do not have bread, only a handful of flour in a bin and a little oil in a jar. And see, I am gathering a couple of sticks that I may go in and prepare it for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die. Okay, so now we have this lady, and she is gathering sticks, and he found her, and he knew instantly, this is the lady. This is the one who I need to actually go to. So he goes over to her and he tells her, please bring me a little water in a cup that I may drink. Now, if you can just think about this story, and if you happen to be, you know, I don't know, have you ever asked water from a stranger before? Yeah, some of you may have. Okay, that's good. And I hope they gave you water. And so here Elijah comes over, and this widow must be thinking, oh, you need water. And back then in the desert, you know, well, if you're in the Middle East, if you're in the desert anyway, in the Arabian sort of area, if someone needs water, you give them water. You know, you don't deny anyone from water. So Elijah here is seeking for this water. Now, it's interesting too, I just want to reflect on the story of this woman. Because according to Spirit of Prophecy, it says that God saw how this woman had lived her life, and that she lived it according to what she knows. So she may not be an Israelite. She may not have the promises of God. She may not have the inheritance of blessings that God promises to the Israelites. She is a Gentile. She's a heathen. But this woman lived according to what she knew. According to the light that she knew. And God knew also that she was a woman who was very hospitable. And whoever it is that came to her, she would provide. So even though she was a widow, she was a generous widow. So God knew that if Elijah was to be taken somewhere, he would take her there. And you know, the work of this woman is such that Jesus quoted her as well. Jesus says, this woman, I mean the faith of this woman from this widow of Zarephath. And so there is something really special about this woman, because even though she didn't know everything, but she lived according to what her conscience said. And that tells me something. That actually rebukes me in many ways. And I would ask, have I lived according to what I know? And so the first lesson that I have here is that live the light that you've been given rather than living what you like. Because oftentimes, there is a struggle here often when we know what is right, but we also know what we like. And we don't necessarily live according to what we know what is right, but according to what we know what is satisfies our needs, or satisfies our desires, satisfies our likings. Yeah, what is comfortable for us. So here this woman, she's not a believer. And yet God respected her. There could have been many other widows in Israel who could have helped Elijah. Someone who is supposed to know the truth, but God couldn't select any other widow but her. That's amazing. That's a real testimony of this woman. I want to share with you. So Elijah, he asks for water and she gives it. So I want to share with you something that I'm really shameful of. And I call it the blue bottle lesson. And I'm shameful this for the fact that, I mean, this happened quite a number of years ago. I've shared this with a number of people in the past, and I'm sorry if you've heard it already, but I thought this was really appropriate for this story. It reminded me of this experience that I had with this blue bottle. I was coming home from work, and I was working in Darlinghurst at the time. And if you know Darlinghurst, to go home is for me to either walk to Town Hall, which I sometimes do, or otherwise I catch a train from King's Cross Station, and then I go to Town Hall and change at Town Hall, and then go over to the north to go home. So this was on a Tuesday early evening. And I got onto the train, and the train was, of course, packed. It's peak hour. And anyway, I was sitting in the carousel area, and opposite me was this man who I'm familiar with his face. When you work around that area, you get to be familiar with the people who are around, who are walking around, and particularly when there are a number of because we've got the injection place as well there, so there's a number of people who visit there, and I could see that he's the man who struggles with drug addiction. So anyway, this man was sitting in front of me, and there was another lady who doesn't really know him. And so she says to this man, "You look rather pale." And so there'll be this little balloon over my head, if you imagine it as a comic. And I'm thinking, he always looks pale. And so she goes, "You look a little pale. Are you unwell?" And I'm thinking, well, he's probably unwell. And he goes, "Yeah, I feel a little bit unwell." She goes, "Maybe you need some water." And so he goes, "Oh yeah, that would be nice if I could get some water." And so she then proceeded to ask everyone in the train and says loudly, "Does anyone have any water?" And I'm thinking, well, I've got my water, but I've got my water in my water bottle, right? And I've got my water bottle where? In my bag. So you can't really see my water, that my water bottle in my bag. And I'm thinking, well, I can give him my water bottle, but then I wouldn't want to have my water bottle back because I'm a bit of a germaphobe. And so I thought about it, came to Martin Place, the door started opening, and it's like, should I give him my water bottle? And I thought, no, he's probably gonna get off soon at Central anyway, and he can get the water bottle from someone else or from somewhere when he gets off the train. And so I continued to ponder, and there was this battle going on in my mind, and I'm thinking, well, no one else is responding to it, and I'm sure someone else has like a water bottle. So in the fact that no one else was responding, you know, why should I be responding to this? And so then I'm thinking, well, maybe I should just give my water bottle. It's like, but I like my water bottle. Anyway, you understand what my dilemma was at the time. So then, as I was still thinking, the door for Town Hall Station opened, and I'm thinking, that's my exit, gotta go. I haven't made my decision yet, so I went, and I went to my platform, and I stood there, and I'm thinking, here I am, I'm going to my Bible study. I'm going to my house, where I'm opening my house for everyone to come, and that we'll be providing food. And I thought, what a hypocrite. You couldn't even give him a water bottle. And in fact, I judged him whether or not he deserves my water bottle. And in fact, I just thought, well, you know, my water bottle is that precious. I mean, blue is not even my favorite color. Why wouldn't I just give it away? So I thought at that point, that was not nice. I should have given my water to that man. And God rebuked me at that point. Anyway, I was sharing this story to my mom, and she kind of went, oh, okay, well, you know, I don't know, yeah. And then a month later, I lost my water bottle. And that, to me, was a strong slap from God. And he said, Christiana, you have something because you need to give it. You don't have something because for you to keep. You have it so then you can share it. What you have does not belong to you. What you have belongs to me. But I give it to you so then you can bless another person. So ever since then, anyone wants to have something from me, I just take it. You know, I don't want to have this burden, because everything that I receive is from God. And that was just such a huge lesson for me. And ever since then, I just remember the blue bottle lesson. If something happens and, you know, I need to give something, the blue bottle lesson. And praise God, how he rebukes us and how he wants to teach us a lesson every day. And sometimes even just for the small things in life, he tests us. And especially in our walk with God. And here I am, I'm a Christian, and I'm a faithful Christian. Faithful Seventh-day Adventist. I go to church, and yet I couldn't even give something so small to someone, and something insignificant. So here we have this blue bottle lesson, and I hope that this also speaks to your heart. But this woman, she lived what she knew, rather than what she liked. And there is a verse here in Luke 9, verse 23, and Jesus is actually commanding us and rebuking us as well. If anyone desires to come after me, Let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. Here is another. Jesus then takes it further. Not only that he wants us to be able to receive blessing from him and that we can give it to another, but he also wants us to experience denial of ourselves. And you know, the biggest battle that we have and the biggest battle that I had in my heart at that time was myself. What I wanted, rather than me denying, oh, it's not about me. It's about, you know, what God wants me to do. And I think of this quote from Steps to Christ. The warfare against self is the greatest battle that was ever fought. Scary, isn't it? The warfare against self is the greatest battle. Forget the devil. I mean, yeah, he exists. But the greatest battle is actually ourselves, not even the devil. The yielding of self, surrendering all to the will of God, requires a struggle, but the soul must submit. So God is saying, hey, struggle is necessary. I'm not saying that everyone has to struggle all the time, but struggle, when it does come, God is trying to tell us something. And it says, but the soul must submit to God before it can be what?
Renewed in holiness.
It can be renewed in holiness. So at times when we are struggling with something and we, I don't know. And Jesus says, you know, must carry the cross, take up the cross and deny yourself and follow after me. And when we're struggling with this, I don't know what to do. But when we submit to God, that's when God says, okay, I can work with you. I'll work with you further in this because you have now submitted yourself. Even if it's a small step, God wants to always use every opportunity of struggle in our lives as an opportunity for him to teach us a lesson and for him to also then remake of what is really in our hearts. Amen? We have a God who is a transforming God. We have a God who is also very generous. We have a God who is so faithful in all of his promises that he will not deny what we ever need. He will provide. But the thing is, we need to then submit ourselves to him. And he says, when you submit to me, I'll work on you even further. And sometimes that's difficult. Here's another quote. The life spent on self is like the grain that is eaten. It disappears, but there is no increase. That's sad. Life spent on self has no increase. And he says, a man may gather all he can for self. He may live and think and plan for self, but his life passes away and he has nothing. The law of self-serving is the law of self-destruction. What a powerful quote, but what a difficult statement. And you know why it's difficult? Because we're thinking, how can we ever do it? But praise God, God does not only just provide what we need, but he will also provide us the power. Ephesians 3:20 says that now to him is able to do exceedingly above all that we can ever ask or think, isn't it? So if we want to actually, Lord, I want to be able to submit to you. Lord, I want to be able to work with you. I want you to be able to work in me and help me to be able to be open to your leading. Help me to be able to be mentored by you. Help me to be able to know how to actually listen to you and how to actually then follow you. So Elijah followed him. And this woman, this widow, she also followed him. Okay, I'll keep going. Elijah's faith then allowed this woman to further exercise her faith before she even really realized that she had any faith in God. Because it goes on further in when we were reading before. After he asked her for water, so she was about to get it, she goes, okay, I'll give you water. That's not difficult. Now Elijah says, sorry. You know, also just pass me a morsel of bread, you know, on your way back. And she's thinking, okay, he hasn't got a clue of what's going on in my life. And she's like, I better tell this man. I'll give him water, but that is it. Because she then says, to him. And I'm not sure if she says in a polite way or she's like, as the Lord your God lives, or I don't know. But anyway, she just says, as the Lord your God lives, I do not have bread. And so what she says is that she only, well, this is probably a bit more than a handful, but this is just for the sake of showing you something. As the Lord your God lives, I do not have bread, only a handful of flour in a bin. A handful. This is a little bit more than a handful. Praise God, or we have enough rice at the back. A handful of flour in a bin. And what did she say there? And a little oil in a jar. This is corn syrup, but that, you know what I mean. This is all I have. And she said, can you expect me to make you something? And in fact, she says, I'll tell you this, because I am gathering a couple of sticks when you saw me before, and I am doing that because I'm going to prepare my last meal with me and my son before we die. That's a pretty tragic thing, isn't it? So here this woman is like saying, I've got nothing, mate. I'll give you water, but that's all I have. But what did God say to her? Well, God says to Elijah, ask her. And so Elijah then says to her, don't fear. Go and do as you have said, but make me a small cake first. And bring it to me, and then afterward, make some for yourself and your son. So then she's thinking, well, who are you? Now you're saying that I just told you that I only have enough for me and my son, and now you tell me that I have to make you something first and then there'll be enough for me and my son? You know, she's like, okay, do I risk my life by trusting this man, or do I just, you know, just do what I think is right? Do what I think is what I can see, you know, live according to what I can see. And so the thing is, the word says, in verse 14, for thus says the Lord God of Israel, the bin of flour shall not be used up, nor shall the jar of oil run dry until the day the Lord sends rain on the earth. Now this man's talking further, and she's thinking, okay, he's saying something a little bit more here. She's talking about rain. So he's saying, he is giving me a guarantee that my oil and my flour will never run dry until the rain comes. Until I can actually, you know, have more vegetation in my land and that I can provide for myself and my son. And she's thinking, well, what do I do? Should I go ahead with this? And you know what? She did. In verse 15 says, so she went away and did according to the word of Elijah, and she and her household, what happened? They ate for many days. It's not just even many days. I mean, that's even an underestimation. Elijah was staying with this woman for almost 3 years, because it says that the famine was 3 years. 3 years. And according to, that's according in James, you can find that he was there and the Israelites were suffering in that 3 years. And this woman, little did she have, she was provided for. Completely. Every single day God had given her provision. Amen? Wow. And this would be such an eye-opening to her. And so another lesson that we can learn from the widow, give what you have. Because what you have does not come from you. But where does it come from? God. It comes from God. And of course, after that, you know, she received. And I think of some of these verses. This woman, she received a prophet, and she received a prophet's reward. This is what the promises says. She was not, I mean, she's not even aware of these promises, right? She's a heathen. She's not a believer. But she was not forgetting to entertain even strangers. And because she ended up entertaining a prophet of God. And it says in 2 Corinthians 9:8, God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that ye always having all sufficiency in all things may abound to every good work. God wants to give us that we will be able to give to another. God wants to provide, for us that we will be able to provide for another's need. Amen? That's exciting. It's exciting that God actually wants to, use us as his instruments. God wants to actually give us things, and the things that he gives us are responsibilities. They're not for us to keep. And if you can turn to 2 Corinthians 9, and just briefly, 2 Corinthians 9 in your Bible. I'm going to read it. And in verse 10, and it says, now may he who supplies seed to the sower, the bread for the food, supply and multiply the seed you have sown and increase the fruits of your righteousness, while you are enriched in everything for all liberality, which causes thanksgiving through us to God. For the administration of this service not only supplies the needs of the saints, but also is abounding through many thanksgiving to God. That's biblical. God says, you receive because you are going to give. Just the same as the gospel. You receive because you're going to give it to someone. And you know what? I failed to do that. I had water and I didn't give it. And that's just something so small. And I wonder, maybe sometimes God is trying to test us in the small things in life so that he can know and prepare us for the greater things. The greater things that someone is going to be needing. And this woman, she provided for Elijah for almost 3 years. Amazing. She was able to provide for this man. Now, I'll continue on. And the thing is, what's also, I've got this other thing, quote from Charles Spurgeon says, never try to save out of God's cause. Such money will canker the rest. Giving to God is no loss. It is putting your substance in the best bank. Giving is true, having as the old gravestone said of the dead man, what I spent had, what I saved, I lost, what I gave, I have. Another lesson from the widow is that she stepped out in faith in what God has promised, and God blessed it and multiplied it. She didn't think, I'm just imagining when she's doing this, making this cake for Elijah for the first time. She's trying, all right, you said make him a cake first, and then I am going to make a cake for me and my son after that. Okay, well, let's see. And she's pouring and she's pouring. She's like, oh, okay, all right, that's usually enough. And she put it down. Oh, there is enough for me. She used the oil. Put it down. Ah, there is enough for me to make another batch. That's amazing. I wish that happens to me in the kitchen sometimes when I'm making it, if I'm running out or something. But that's like God just every single day. There's enough for tomorrow. Oh, there's enough for tomorrow. Amazing. And what, you know what she needed to do? She just needed to step out in faith. She had no preconception of what's going to happen, but she just trusted in the word and she obeyed the word. Amen? She trusted in the word and she obeyed the word. And I want to share with you this quote. Faith is taking the first step even when you don't see the whole staircase. That's scary because I'm thinking there's no staircase down there. I ain't going down. But God challenges us. If we know it is according to his word in our decision making, if we know it's according to his word, step out and he will do the rest. He will be the one who will be providing. I want to share with you also this verse in Matthew 21. And please come with me to this verse. Matthew 21. Verse 21. I just want to share with you something. Matthew 21, verse 21. Coming to a close soon. They're all standing around the fig tree right now, and it's a withered fig tree. And they're all saying, oh, the disciples thought, with Jesus, they were saying, How did the fig tree wither away so soon? And then Jesus says this, surely I say to you, if you have faith, what does it say?
And do
not doubt. What happens? What happens? If you have faith and you do not doubt, you will not only do what was done to the fig tree, but also if you say to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, it will be done. Wow. Okay. Just think of that. If you have faith and what? Do not doubt. Okay, let's go to Mark 11. Mark 11, verse 23 and 24. Verse 22 to 24, actually. Mark 11, verse 22 to 24. And Jesus says this, have faith in God. For surely I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and does not, what?
Doubt
in his heart, but believes that those things he says will be done, he will have whatever he says. Therefore I say unto you, whatever things you ask, when you pray, believe that you receive them, and you will have them. Okay, turn with me also further. James 1, verse 5 and 6. Towards the end, James 1, verse 5 and 6. And it says, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all liberally, amen, liberally, and without reproach, amen, and it will be given to him. And in verse 6 it says, but let him ask in faith with? Without wavering, or another translation, with no doubting. For he who doubts is like a wave of the sea driven and tossed by the wind. So God is like saying here, what Jesus is saying, hey, have faith. But when you have faith, don't doubt. Because you know what? We can have faith and we can also doubt. We have faith because the word of God tells us. We were singing before, standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of God. And suddenly I can't remember the rest of the word. But you know what I mean? Standing on the promises of God is what? Having
faith.
But oftentimes, what do? We have faith and we go, well, that's what the word of God says, but maybe that doesn't apply to me. Because that's not going to happen. But God says, if you have faith, don't doubt. So there is a requirement, and Jesus even says that if you have faith as small as the mustard seed, you can move mountains. And I'm thinking, wow, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, okay, so you don't really need a lot of faith, right? I mean, have you seen a mustard seed? It's like tiny. It's really tiny. And if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, even if it's only very little, and no doubt, you can actually move mountains. So the problem that we have is not the fact that we lack in faith, but we're great in doubt. Mm-hmm. And this woman, I'm sure she doubted in her heart. But she went, okay, you know what? I'm going to trust this man. I'll trust this man and he will be able to pour the flour. I'll pour the flour, it'll be there enough for me. I'll pour the oil, it'll be there enough for me. Because, well, he said it. All right. Let's do it. And she was able to provide for her and her son for a number of years. Well, for 2.5 to 3 years. However long that it took for Elijah to be in the brook of Cherith. But here we can learn from this story that God wants us to know that we can have faith in his word and not doubt it. And so the lessons from the widow is live the light, then live to your liking, because she lived the light to what she knew, rather than lived it because of what she thinks is right or what she thinks is what she wants. Give what you have, because what you have does not come from you, but it comes from God. And believe in him, in what he has promised, because he will bless it and multiply it. And I just want to add there, have faith. And you know what? This sermon, I wrote this sermon because I was doing a morning devotional. And this sermon, this message spoke to my heart. And that was a message that God went, Christiana, this is for you. Hello, Christiana. Like, what are you gonna do about this? And I just wanna share this, extend this to you, and may this be something that can resonate in your heart and challenge you also in your relationship with God, and to know that God will supply all your need according to his riches. We have a rich God, and we have a wonderfully generous God, and we just need to trust that what he provides is really good for us. Amen?
Amen.
Thank you, Christiana, and for Christiana's final selection for this morning, we will sing hymn number 608, Faith is a Victory. So may we all please stand.
With all the many blessings that we have received, we give thanks to you. And Father in heaven, help us, Lord, to live according to what we know, what you have given to us. Fill us with the Holy Spirit. Touch our hearts. Help us to be open to your leading. Guide us. Direct us, Lord, and use us, that your name will be glorified. That we may be a blessing to another, that another person's faith will also be drawn to you. Father in heaven, thank you for this church. Thank you for Fountain Maroubra and Fountain the City and for the family that is here. And we pray that you will continue to bless each person here, Lord, and bless the work in this community, and that many people will come to know your truth because of what you've given to us already. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.